Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you all here today. Brenda, thank you for playing pre-music, and I'll thank you again in a few minutes for the prelude. Announcements, prayer requests, praises. Does anybody have anything they'd like to share this morning?
I want to thank my son, Richard. He comes clear over from Freeville to be to church every Sunday, and I really appreciate it, and I love him.
Thank you, Richard. And we have somebody here from Missouri. Seth, it's good to see you.
I would like continued prayer for my friend Jen's family and her mom. Her mom is at home right now, and they're doing pain medication and stuff to try and help her deal with the pain in her back from the cancer. They're still waiting on a surgeon to find out. The most important surgeon they tried to get a hold of decided he couldn't do it. So now they're looking for one who will be able to help them out.
Thank you, Bonnie. Others? Yes, Seth.
It's good to see everyone again. so I have had a friend that's been visiting here. His mother is not in good shape. I think her kidneys are failing from the last time that I talked to him, and he's not doing very well. So if you could just keep him in your prayers, he's pretty young, and I can't imagine being without my own mother, so.
Thank you, Seth. Making me walk this morning, everyone.
Well, the good news is Clyde is 2 years old today. And we want to thank you for the prayers for Bob. He's not 100%, but he's doing much better. So thank you.
Good news on both.
I imagine that most of you have heard about the terrible accident and death of Mary Louise Church, who touched so many lives in our community on Friday afternoon and, well, Saturday. And so we should all keep their family in prayer. They've had more than one tragedy in the last couple of years. And then I'll tell you also that we're leaving, hopefully on Thursday, for the rest of the winter. And we ask for travel mercies. We're supposed to have snow in the middle states, the Carolinas, and so on. So keep us in prayer, please.
Sure thing, I guess. Anybody else? We're thankful you're here also. It's good to see you, Yvonne. Well, not seeing any more hands, Brenda, again, we will thank you for playing for us, and we will now hear your prelude. Thank you.
Thank you. I said, it's good to see all of you here this morning. Thanks for coming out on this cold, cold morning. I love to be here and worship God together with you. But for the next few weeks, I won't be here worshiping God with you. I'll be in a warmer climate. Oh, am I doing the dual thing? No. Yes, how about that? Ruth Ann has already taken the flight down to Orlando and the drive up north to the Ocala National Forest, and out in the middle of those woods some places where my grandchildren live. And it's Wesley's birthday, and so she wanted to get down there ahead of time and celebrate his birthday with him. And I'll be joining them soon, but probably not leaving tomorrow morning because of what they call in this thing, Izzy? That storm, winter storm Izzy, is changing my travel plans. So I appreciate your prayers. I'll be praying for Beverly and Bob as they travel, and I know you don't feel sorry for us at all. We're leaving this cold climate to be someplace warmer. I have a call to worship for you this morning from Psalm 34. I'm just going to read some selected verses from Psalm 34. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. I will glory in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and he delivered me from all my fears. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. The righteous person may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. The Lord will rescue his servants, and no one who takes refuge in him will be condemned. Let us open our service this morning with prayer. Father, we're so grateful. Grateful that we can come into this place, gather in your name and worship you. That you have made it possible that we can talk to you at any time. And help us not to take that for granted, but to learn what it means to pray without ceasing, to be in constant communication with you. I see these people with their cell phones texting all the time, and that's what we should be doing, praying all the time, talking to you many times throughout the day. But this morning, we've come here to not only talk to you, but to listen to you, to experience your presence, to feel your Holy Spirit moving among us, to receive forgiveness and mercy and grace and all the good things that come from being with you. We begin this morning by just humbling ourselves, inviting you to forgive our sins, because you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Won't you come with your mercy and grace to us this morning? For we are in need of your forgiveness, your mercy, and grace. Won't you reach forth your hand to heal in the hearts and the lives of those people that we talked about this morning? We continue to pray for Mark, for healing for him. We're thankful that Bob is improving, but we pray for a complete healing and health and recovery for him. Lord, we pray for Jen's mom, who's gone through an awful ordeal. Pray for help with pain management. Lord, that you'd come to this family with mercy and with grace, and that you'd help them find the right treatment. Most of all, that they would know that they're in your hands and in your care. We also pray for the mom of Seth's friend. Lord, that you would bring comfort, that you would bring help, that the family would know that we are praying for them and that you care for them. Lord, we place each one in your hand. Ask that this time they would come closer to you, come to know you better, and to receive mercy and grace and help in this time of need. Lord, we pray for the family of Mary Church. This terrible accident and a very difficult way to go home. And it's a shock to the family. But Lord, we pray that you'd come with a comfort that only you can give, with a peace that we all know we can have that peace because we know she is with you. In your arms of mercy, in your loving arms, for all eternity now. Just be with her. Be with their family. And be with the family of Kevin. Joe has asked us to pray for Kevin so many times throughout the year, and Lord, he's no longer with us either. Pray for, once again, your comfort, your strength, your grace. And be with all of our many church family and church friends, our neighbors, those who are near and dear to us, and everyone has issues. Everyone has things they're dealing with. Some of us feel that they're not even worth mentioning in prayer, but Lord, I pray that you'd hear our unspoken request, that you'd lift those burdens, that you'd strengthen the weak, that you'd be present with those who are lonely, that you'd comfort those who mourn, that you'd heal those who are sick, that you'd do what you do when your power and your spirit is present in our lives. We're grateful that Clyde is too. I can remember praying for Clyde many times. Many times we wondered if he would even make it, if he would be here at all, if he'd ever come home from the hospital, but now he is home and he's two, and he's doing everything a two-year-old would do. I thank you for and now, Lord, we pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we give our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As the children are excused to children in worship, won't you join me in singing a couple of the old faithful songs, I Am Thine, O Lord. I think you need to stand up and move around, get moving a little bit, warm it up in here a little bit if you can, and just for today only, it's okay if you dance or do something to warm things up a little bit in here. Let's take a moment and dedicate our offerings to him this morning. Father, we're so grateful for all your goodness and all your gifts to us. We're especially grateful this morning for heat and for sunshine and for warm clothes and warm homes to be in. But Father, you've provided everything that we need. Food to eat, clothes to wear, friends and family to love, this place to come and worship and serve you. And so, we dedicate our lives to you. We offer to you our hands for your service, our hearts for your home, a portion of our substance to use for your glory. Pray that you'll multiply this and use it to further your kingdom in this place, in this community, and around the world. In Jesus' name. Amen. Take just one moment and greet those around you this morning. Say good morning, stay warm, whatever you say. It's amazing how quickly you folks settled down this morning without Ruth Ann here to stir things up. I'll pay for that one. It's, as always, it's a pleasure and honor and a privilege to be here with you this morning and have the opportunity to share his precious and powerful word with you. It's God's word that's made the difference in our lives. God's word is a light that guides our path, that directs our way. God's word is like a hammer, and it pounds that point home that God is speaking to us. God's word is like a sword that pierces deep within, that we might have grace to repent, receive forgiveness and mercy. God's word tells us clearly the way of salvation so that we can have the hope of living throughout all eternity with the one who knows us best and loves us most. It's a pleasure and a privilege and an honor to share God's powerful word with you. Today, I'm going to be looking at James chapter 4, and in the book of James, James, as you know, was the brother of our Lord, and he wasn't a believer when they were children or even growing up. And even when Jesus began his ministry, I think he was among the doubters. And yet later on, after the resurrection of Christ, he became a pillar in the church and a leader of the church. And he writes his letter to the 12 tribes who are scattered throughout the world just to remind Christians how we should live, how we should act, he's had several points in his book of James, in his letter of James, that are critical. James has a way of just telling it like it is. and not holding anything back. And so when you read the book of James, he's managing our lives as Christians. He's telling us how to deal with some of these issues that trouble us in our personal walk with Christ and in our walk with one another with Christ. Now, before we get started, I want to tell you a story. This is a story you already know and you've already heard, and you probably heard it many times, and you probably heard it when you were just a little child. And there's some, because it's a very old story, there's some variations in the story. So I'm going to take a little liberty as I tell this story, but I think it'll be the perfect introduction for my key thought for today. And it's a story about a young lady who decides to visit her grandma who lives out in the woods. And she's going to take her grandma some goodies, and I just picked out some baked goods. It might have been cookies, it might have been muffins, it might have been Lindt chocolate. I don't know what she was bringing to grandma. Let me put in a pitch for grandma. It's a good idea to visit grandma. It's a good, as a grandpa, as a papa, it's a good idea to visit grandma, to call her up, to send her cards, to let her know you love her, to bring her some goodies. And she likes, grandma, I can assure you, likes goodies. And even if she doesn't like the goodies, she'll tell you she likes them because you brought them. So make sure you visit grandma and think of grandma. Anyway, Little Red Riding Hood was on her way to Grandma's house with some goodies, and she ran into the big bad wolf, who is kind of an unsavory character, not the kind of guy you want to hang out with. And he managed to finagle out of Little Red Riding Hood where she was going with these goodies, and he went ahead of her to Grandma's house. And this is where the story, there's many variations of the story, but for this version of the story, we'll say he locked Grandma in the closet. And then he took Grandma's pajamas, her nightgown, and her nightcap and put it on and got in Grandma's bed so that he could fool Little Red Riding Hood. Well, soon after that, there was a knock on the door, and he said, "Come in, my dear." He really didn't have a very good grandma's voice, but he said to Little Red Riding Hood, "Come closer, my dear, so I can see you." At this point, Little Red Riding Hood looked grandma in the eyes and said, "My grandma, what big eyes you have." And he said, "The better to see you with. Come closer, my dear, so I can hear you." And at this point, Little Red Riding Hood noticed what big ears Grandma had in. And she said, "Grandma, what big ears you have." "The better to hear you with, my dear. Come closer." And at this point, Little Red Riding Hood is right there beside the bed, and she says, "Grandma, what big teeth you have." And the wolf said, "The better to eat you with," and pounced out of the bed and jumped on Little Red Riding Hood. And well, at this point, the story has many different varieties too. So if you think this, that the Little Red Riding Hood beats up the wolf, turn to page 92 or whatever. You can, the point of the me telling this story is not so that you visit your grandma and not so you hear the end of the story. The point is this: when we get closer, we can hear more easily. We can see more clearly, and we can know more fully. As we consider the text this morning in James chapter 4, his challenge to us in verse 4, or chapter 4, verse 8 is, come near to God, and He will come near to you. Why? Because when we get closer, we can hear more easily. We can see more clearly, and we can know more fully. I'm reading from James chapter 4, verse 1. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle from within you? You desire but do not have, so you kill. You covet but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. And when you ask, you do not receive because you ask with the wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that He jealously longs for the Spirit He has caused to dwell in us? But He gives us more grace. That is why the Scripture says God opposes the proud but shows favor to the humble. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and He will lift you up. Let us pray. Father, we're grateful for Your Word, because Your Word tells us what we need to hear and what we need to know. Your Word gives us the path of salvation. Your Word directs us in the way we should live our life. Your Word promises us Your great love, of forgiveness, of mercy, of grace, of salvation, and the hope of eternal life with You forever. So, Father, as we consider Your Word this morning, help us. Help us to draw near to You, to come near to You. We ask that You would come near to us. May Your Holy Spirit touch our ears, that we might hear better. Open our eyes that we might see more clearly, and work in our hearts in such a way that we believe and receive from You, that You would grow our faith and grow us closer to You, and that we might know You more fully. In Jesus' name, amen. When we get closer, we can hear more easily, we can see more clearly, and we can know more fully. James starts out this portion of his letter with a question that was relevant and pertinent in the people he was addressing back then. And as a pastor, I love this because it's relevant and pertinent today. Because believe it or not, I still hear of churches who have fights and quarrels among them. It just amazes me if you go over, well, if you study church history, or if you talk to other pastors and other people who've been in church, or if, like me, you've been in many churches in your life, it's astounding the things that divide up church, or that church people fight over, and it extends from what kind of coffee we're going to serve during coffee hour to who's cleaning and what vacuum we're using or what vacuum we should purchase or who's cleaning what when. There is no limit to the amount of things that people can disagree on and the amount of things that people can fight about and quarrel over. This is how I know the Scripture is relevant and pertinent for today, because the same problems they had back then are some of the same problems that we have today. Now, I understand, unless I'm alone in the room, there's probably going to be a disagreement. If there's more than one person in a room, there's probably going to be some things you disagree on with somebody. Even Ruth Ann and I disagree once in a while. I will point out at this point, yes, dear, you're right, okay? Just to clear the record. But if there's more than two people, double the amount. Say there's four people, well, you're probably going to double the amount of disagreements. And if that gets up to 8 or 10 or 12, there's even more disagreements. And if there's 50 or 100 or 1,000, there's an even greater chance for disagreements. We aren't expected to all have the same opinion about everything, but we are expected to disagree agreeably. Because we have so much in common. It's God the Father Almighty who made heaven and earth and everything in it, including us. He made all of us, and we all worship the one true God, the Father. We've all been saved by the same precious blood, the gift of God's Son, who went to the same old rugged cross and shed his blood forgive our sins. We've all been filled with the same Holy Spirit. We all, for the most part, study the same Word of God. We all have the same hope of eternal life. We have so much that we have in common. We mustn't let these little things divide us. Thankfully, James not only asks the question to kind of point out the problem or put his finger on the problem, he asks and answers his own question. Right here in this short little passage, he tells us where the problem comes. It comes from inside of us. It comes from inside of us. It's our desires, our wants, our own selfishness that causes the problems. It's a light that should come on inside of us when we realize that the problem isn't with everyone else, the problem is with me. Now, I've met a lot of people. I hear this occasionally as a pastor. I hear a lot of people complain about their pastor. They don't like their pastor. I don't hear so many people complaining specifically about me, but I hear them complain about their pastor. They save their complaints about me for somebody else's ears. Thank the Lord. But then I find out those same people were complaining about the pastor before that, and the pastor before that, and the pastor before that, and when the new pastor comes, they're going to complain about them too. And some of these people, they, instead of complaining, they just go to a new church and then they complain about that pastor. It never occurs to them that all of the pastors in the world aren't wrong. The problem might be right here. Same thing with people who, well, get married and divorced and married and divorced or married and divorced, or maybe they just skip the marriage part, they live together and they move on to the next and move on to the next, and they think that every man or every woman in the world is crazy. And you probably could make a case for that, but chances are the problem isn't with everyone else. The problem is with me. It's when I allow God to change me that it allows me to get along with others. You see, it's my desire, my greed, my pride, my arrogance, my insistence on having my own way. This idea in my head that I'm right and everybody else is wrong. It's a toxic attitude for a believer in Christ. it's my desires, my greed, my pride, my arrogance, my insistence on having my own way that are the root cause of my problems as a person, as an individual, in relationships, and in the church. And James doesn't only ask and answer these questions, he also provides a solution right here in this same little text. The solution for these continual wars that go on between us and among us is actually quite simple. I say it's simple. It's easy to say. It's not easy to do. But he gives us some steps that we can do that is going to help us deal with this problem. Remember, the problem isn't the quarreling and fighting. That's just the symptoms of the problem. The problem is the greed, the pride, the arrogance, the selfishness. All of those things that make us impossible to live with. And the first thing he says is that we must humble ourselves. I just find it so interesting because maybe God is speaking just to me. But everywhere I look, I keep reading these scriptures about humility. Here is James saying, God opposes the proud but shows favor to the humble. A couple weeks ago, or maybe it was just last week, I read in Peter, and he was talking about being humble. And I know that Paul says we need to prefer one another above ourselves. He talks about humility too, and Christ talked about humility too. He said, in fact, we need to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow him. And Jesus said we must be the servant of all. He who would be great among you, let him be servant of all. Jesus not only talked about humility, but he was humble. See, if there's more humility in the room, there's less of I'm right and everybody else is wrong. Just no room for that attitude. There's more room for the attitude, gee, we need to love one another, care for one another, respect one another, listen to one another. Why? Because we're humble. Why? Because they were created and purchased by God too. And so their opinion matters. Their view of the world matters. It's more important to love somebody than to be right about everything. Next, James tells us we must submit to God. If we are all submitted to God, that doesn't leave much room for fighting and quarreling. If we're submitted to God, then we hear the words, love one another, serve one another, listen to one another, bear one another's burdens, pray for one another. The list goes on and on. When we're submitted to God, when we're taking up our cross, denying ourselves, taking up our cross and following him, there's less time and space for fighting with one another. Then James throws in this one, resist the devil and he will flee from you. I wondered, why does he throw that in there? Well, because the devil is like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. You see, whenever you have strife, dissension, division, anger, frustration, fear, that's the devil's playground. That's where he works the best. He's the author of division. And so when we're tempted to take that route, we're playing right into his hands. Now, I will point out that Peter wrote, he's like a roaring lion. He's not actually a roaring lion, but his strategies are like a lion. I remember seeing a National Geographic special years and years ago in which the lion was going after the wildebeest. There was a whole herd of wildebeest, and probably if they stood up to the lion, he couldn't do much, but he ran right at him, growling and roaring, and divided the wildebeest herd in half. Then he took that half group, and he ran at them, roaring, charging, and divided that group. And after about 20 minutes, he had singled out one weak, lame little wildebeest, and he moved in for the kill and took him down. That's how the enemy works. When he can divide us, when he can single us out, he can take us down. But if we stand together in humility before God, submitting to God, loving and caring for one another, the devil doesn't really have any place to work. And then James writes, come near to God, and he will come near to you. You see, when you come near to God, when we get closer, we can hear more easily, we can see more clearly, and we can know more fully. The answer to our problems is not just to stop quarreling. The answer to this root problem in here is actually to come near to him. Listen to his voice. Be led by his spirit. Allow him to help you follow his word. Come near to him, and he will come near to you. You know, when you're near him, the devil doesn't want anything to do with you. He keeps his distance because God is bigger and stronger and more powerful, and he knows it. If you're in his presence, if you're talking to him daily, if you're doing things that bring you closer to God, and God will come closer to you, and you'll experience peace and power and mercy and grace and blessing and favor, because God opposes the proud but gives favor and grace and mercy to the humble who come near to him. James tells us, he's telling us how to do that. Be humble. Submit to God. Ignore and resist the devil. Come close to God, and he will come near to you. You know, every day we make many, many choices, multiple choices. Over the course of a lifetime, thousands and thousands, maybe even millions of choices. And I have to say, if I look at my own life, most of these choices have to do with what I want. Not denying myself at all. I take pretty good care of myself. It's easy to choose what I want. But when we choose what he wants, that will bring us closer to him. For instance, let me just throw out a couple examples. When you choose not to forgive somebody, does that choice bring you closer to God or farther away from God? When you choose to read a harlequin romance novel instead of his word, does that bring you closer to God or farther away from God? When you choose to go have brunch on Sunday morning instead of come and worship and fellowship with his people. Does that choice bring you closer to God or further away from God? If we examine our choices, we can make choices that will bring us closer to God. And when you come closer to him, he will come closer to you. He promises it. And when you get closer to God, you can hear him. You can hear him better. You can see him in his glory more clearly. And you will know him more fully. You can say, I don't hear him very good, or at all. Then that just tells me you need to get closer. Can you read this? Of course not. You need to get closer. Can you hear this? We need to get closer. Some country girl sang a song, oh, won't you speak a little louder? Lord Jesus, I can't hear what you're saying. And yet the Bible clearly tells us that God often speaks in a still, small voice. You can only hear him if you're listening. You'll only see him moving in your life if you're looking. And you'll only know him better if you get closer. Let's pray. Father, help us. Help us because we can look at our lives and say that easily, very easily say, that we need to be closer to you. So I ask that you'd help us to do that, that you'd show us the way, that the Holy Spirit would nudge us and push us and draw us into a closer relationship with you. Help us to say no to the things that pull us away and yes to the things that bring us closer. We admit we need your help with this. But we know that if we ask you, you will help us. So won't you help us come closer to you and closer to one another. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's make this next song our prayer. Draw me close to you.
You're all I want.
Father, we just come to you this morning wanting to come closer to you, wanting to experience more of what you have for us, wanting to be the kind of people that you want us to be, and knowing that we can only do that with your help. More of your mercy, more of your grace, more of your love in all of us, we pray. Now may the love of the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the presence and power of his Holy Spirit be with you today and every day. Amen.